Welcome back, everyone, for the last talk of today. Thank you for your attendance. And the rules of the game are the same. We'll try to get through the presentation without questions, unless they are urgent clarifying questions. Okay, let me introduce the speaker. It's truly my pleasure to introduce Daniele Vignoli, who's full professor of demography at the University of Florence. Professor Vignoli received a PhD from La Sapienza, University of Rome, before continuing his career at the University of Florence, where he's currently the scientific coordinator of the Population and Society Unit. He's the principal investigator of three large grants at the moment, the ERC Consolidator Grant, Economic Uncertainty and Fertility in Europe, a Muir Grant on Narratives Around Fertility and Uncertainties, and one of the Great Demographic Recession. Dr. Vignoli is also the editor-in-chief of Genus, and his research has been widely published in all the several journals in demography and sociology, from demography to the European Sociological Review, Population Studies, and so on and so forth. His latest book, Piacere e Fedeltà, came out earlier this year. I haven't read it yet, but in 2020, he was awarded the Dirk van Dekka Award for his outstanding and innovative contributions to the field of social demography. And today we'll hear his talk on fertility in uncertain times, evidence from the COVID-19 pandemic. So the Zoom is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Federica. Thank you very much for the invitation and for this very nice introduction. I'm extremely happy today to be here and to have the possibility actually to share with you some of the most recent research that we are carrying out in Florence and to share with you some reflections about fertility dynamics in the era of uncertainty. And in particular, I will show you some application to the effect of the COVID-19 pandemic on the fertility intentions of Italians. So let's see what happened. The starting point of the presentation is the well-established fact that Europe is facing currently a new fertility winter. Norway reached its lowest total fertility in history in 2020. Finland also reached the lowest total fertility in history in 2019, 1.35, down from 1.9 in 2010. So basically, Finland is approaching the lowest low fertility regime now. A bit farther west, Scotland is also facing declining fertility rates since 2010, and even France is currently experiencing an unexpected fertility decline. The black line here is Italy. As you can see, we were already starting from a quite low level, so we cannot go much down, but still, fertility is decreasing again in Italy since 2010, and the current fertility in 2020 is 1.27, which is closer to the negative record of 1996 than to the fertility rebound of 2008. So the question is why? What is happening? And the central explanation I will try to put forward in this presentation is the rise of uncertainty. The increasing speed, dynamics and volatility of outcomes of globalization and the new wave of technological change make it increasingly difficult for individuals to predict their future and choose between alternatives and strategies. And the Great Recession has renewed the view that globalization is unpredictable and out of control. All this state of affairs generates an extraordinary level of contingent uncertainty, which represents, I argue, the game changer in contemporary societies and family life courses. What has been done so far to operationalize economic uncertainty in demographic research? At the micro level, in micro level research, the empirical demographic tradition usually operationalizes the forces of uncertainty through objective indicators of actual and past labor market conditions, and at best by their subjective perception. Currently, paper addressing the relation between employment uncertainty, which is so far has been traditionally operationalized through unemployment and more recently through the spread of temporary jobs. These kind of papers are now booming. I here suggest a new paper we just published in Demography, which is a meta-analysis that summarizes from a statistical perspective, so it's a quantitative literature review, all what has been published so far in Europe about the relation between temporary jobs, unemployment, and fertility. In addition to this classic research, a new generation of studies also underline the importance of persistence of employment uncertainty in young adults' life courses. So employment uncertainty has been proved to be especially detrimental for fertility when the condition of uncertainty is persistent. Here, what we have done with a couple of colleagues was to develop an index, which we named the Persistent Joblessness Index, that takes simultaneously into account the severity of the experience of joblessness, the chances that an individual will escape joblessness, the alleviating effects of the year spent in continuous employment, and the recentness of any joblessness experience. If you would be interested in using this index, we have now written this data package, which will be soon available, that allows you to compute the index and also each component of this index that they add up one another. We actually tested the effect of this index on fertility intentions, and we proved that disregarding the role of persistence of uncertainty, usually researchers underestimate the importance of individual risk factors linked to labor market biographies in most fertility studies. And finally, a few studies also recognize that uncertainty is not only about employment. Housing uncertainties might be equally important as employment uncertainty at the time of family formation. And here we were collaborating with the University of Southampton, and we have a paper about housing uncertainty using the British Understanding Society panel. So this is what is usually done in fertility studies. I love this type of research. I can actually, of course, continue to do this type of research, but at the same time, these analyses, although certainly informative, leave important questions unanswered. In particular, they pose serious challenges to our understanding of the determinants of fertility. So first of all, in 2009, the Northern European economies resumed their economic growth, but their total fertility rate, which is in Demography the main indicator of fertility, means the average number of children per woman, started to decrease substantially. So the question is, what are the driving forces of fertility decline in Nordic countries after a great recession that actually in hard numbers, they really never experienced, or at least not to any relevant extent? And more generally, what are the driving forces of this new fertility winter that contemporary European societies are currently facing? Actually, these fertility trends also question our main demographic tools in terms of theoretical approaches, because this European post-crisis shift towards very low fertility rates came as highly unexpected, especially in Nordic countries. These Nordic countries, especially from a Southern European perspective, they have been for us the benchmark in terms of gender equality, female labor force participation, youth emancipation, diffusion of new family forms, all factors that are known to be associated with higher fertility, or at least we were used to write so. So the point is, what is happening that our traditional also explanatory approaches are unable to anticipate or predict. So we believe that while the Great Recession is over, uncertainty remains and continue to affect young adults' lives. So the point is, do we understand economic uncertainty? If we come back to the very definition of economic uncertainty, this means lack of clarity about future economic prospects, which in economic terms means unknown probability distributions to possible outcomes. So already from the very definition of uncertainty, what is clear is that uncertainty is about the future, not about the present or the past. And that our cumulative employment disadvantage that we are used to operationalize in many papers just identify what we can call the statistical shadow of the past, but tell us little about uncertain futures. So the idea is that to properly address the effects of uncertainty on family dynamics, we need to slightly change perspective, recognizing that uncertainty is a forward-looking notion. So with this presentation, I argue that uncertainty needs to be conceptualized and operationalized, taking into account that people use works of imagination, producing their own narrative of the future. So uncertainty is strongly anchored in narratives, which are imagined futures embedded in social elements. So these personal narratives of the future are potent driving forces of reproductive decisions to act in spite of uncertainty, or according to uncertainty, but irrespective of structural constraints and their subjective perceptions. Before going to show you some empirical results, I would like to tell you the theoretical framework that we are actually following in our studies. These is what we called narrative framework, and we published in two recent paper, which are only, these are purely theoretical reflections in which we outline the narrative framework. So let me try to present this framework to you and then to offer you some empirical validation of the framework. So first of all, different elements involved in the decision-making process. Of course, the first element is the past experience, past education, employment, partnership, or mobility experiences, just to cite some examples, are clearly crucial. These experiences are then shaped by personal predispositions, like risk aversion or time discounting preferences, or personality traits, more basically, that may influence fertility choices. Then, the second level is the present status. After all, the cumulative past experiences over the life course and the present status are the standard elements that we are used to operationalize in the great majority of sociodemographic studies on fertility intentions and behaviors. The next level concerns perception of the personal condition and of the context. Here, Michaela Kreienfeld, in her popular 2010 article in European Sociological Review, pioneered a new strand of literature in which the perception of the employment condition vis-a-vis the status is considered crucial, because she emphasizes that individuals might differ in the way they feel, tolerate, and react to uncertainty. These three elements together synthesize basically the state of the art of the great majority of demographic studies. We can consider the sum of these elements as the shadow of the past that influenced the decision-making process. So let me try now to add some additional elements to this framework. First of all, expectations, because fertility decisions are not merely a shadow of the past. The specter of the future also matters. What are expectations? Expectations represent what people expect that will happen in the future based on available information. Then expectations are shaped by dreams, desire, or aspiration that we can call as imaginaries. Imaginaries represent the human capacity to place oneself in an imagined situation, also irrespective of the actual condition. Imaginaries are, in this framework, the major source of agency within the course of action. So basically, people can imagine a wishful future and try to reach this imagined future. The final element, all these previous circles find a proper synthesis in the personal narratives of the future, which is our crucial point. At this level, when people plan childbearing, all the previous elements need to find a synthesis that can be actionable. So given given one's own personal predisposition, the past experience, the status, the perceptions, expectations, one's family imaginary. The narrative of the future reflects the actions that will allow an individual to reach the desired family imaginary. And here is what we basically add to the traditional way we are thinking about fertility. This is some of expectations, imaginaries, and narratives of the future represent the shadow of the future that influence the decision-making process. This shadow of the future is what is often disregarded in demographic literature. And as you can see from this stylized representation, just to be clear, I do not consider these different elements in a causal sequence. Simply, each element stems from the previous one, but it exceeds it. In other terms, each new level is influenced, but not determined by the previous one. Then we can add the context. All these different elements that influence the decision-making process are clearly and deeply influenced by the social context, and especially in our time, by the shared narratives spread by the media. You might remember this quotation by Mario Draghi, three simple words, whatever it takes, of the then president of the European Central Bank, which is now our prime minister, proved strong enough to debunk a global financial speculation against the euro in 2012. Of course, the European Central Bank was apparently ready to unleash its monetary power, but this proved to be unnecessary. The narrative of a new attitude towards the future proved enough. And this is actually a textbook example that is usually used to suggest how actors take decisions, not only based on their structural constraints, but also on the narrative of the future. And clearly, personal narratives of the future are anchored in existing cultural and institutional frames, as well as public images produced by the media and the press. So in this framework, a crucial building block of the personal narratives are shared narratives, advanced by online press and social media. This is a sample of article which I wanted to show because they are prior to the COVID-19 pandemic. Then we will discuss how the COVID-19 pandemic is even multiplying this source of uncertainty. But still, we were facing in years in which the economy were going a bit better than in the past. After the Great Recession, the economy was catching up, but the press was clearly full of negative tone in the way they were presenting the economic news. And in addition to the global, and in addition to this economic uncertainty, a global political uncertainty also filtered by the press and the media reinforces the fear of the future. From the most recent Eurobarometer survey, you may have seen it, it emerged that the threat of international political instability was one of the biggest concerns among survey respondents in Europe. So for instance, a long delay of the Brexit process had cast a shadow on the future of everyone, both in the UK and elsewhere. So, and this article from The Guardian is, I think, very illustrative also in the way the press has changed the way of talking about uncertainty by directly entering into the lives of individuals. My Brexit Nightmare, readers on how the uncertainty is affecting their lives. So this global political uncertainty has reinforced the narrative of an uncertain future among young European citizens. So finally, I'm adding the very last element, as I anticipated to you. The final element of this narrative framework is the role of shared narratives that is supposed to be a decisive lens in our understanding of the shadow of the future. So another crucial building block of personal narratives. This is the framework, which I'm presenting you very briefly because I really would like now to operationalize this and to offer you some empirical evidence. The key point and the thesis I would like to put forward in this presentation is that the focus on past and actual structural constraints and their subjective perception is not enough to explain the new fertility winter in Europe. So net of factors, and of course I use on purpose the wording net of factors, because I'm not saying that in the statistical models we should not control for cumulative employment, disadvantage, or actual employment, but net of factors that operationalize the statistical shadow of the past, young adults might postpone fertility because their narrative of the future is uncertain. So how can we operationalize this concept of narratives of the future, and which is the relation with fertility? Actually, in Florence, in the project Economic Uncertainty and Fertility, which is the ERC grant, we are following a fourth trend of research. I will just cite them because I really would like to show you instead some findings related to the COVID-19 pandemic. First of all, what we are doing is to run cross-country laboratory and online experiments to assess the role of different economic narratives of the future in fertility intentions. Actually, you are very expert in conducting experiments. In demography, we are much less expert about experimental research. I'm just showing you the experimental setting of our study. Here, of course, colors symbolize any differentiating attribute among individuals. In our labs, we are using lotteries to also collect a person-specific risk aversion or also attitudes towards uncertainty. Then, mock newspaper stories are used as treatments to manipulate the respondents' perception of a critical situation. In particular, one third of our sample is exposed to a positive or stable narrative of the future, one third to a negative economic narrative of the future, and then we have a control group. Our outcome variables is fertility intentions. Do you intend to have a child in the next 3 years? Actually, in demography, we do collect fertility intentions by explicitly asking, do you intend to have a child in the next 3 years? Because by limiting the time window of the intentions, you get closer to an actual behaviors and you move away from a fertility ideal or a norm. Just a brief glance at the results. Here I'm showing you the results from Florence and Oslo. Basically, we had 800 couples participating to our labs in Florence and 800 couples in Oslo. You can clearly see clear-cut effect of the narratives of the future on fertility intentions. These are predicted fertility intentions on a scale from 0 to 10. Those who were exposed to the positive scenario, they have the highest intentions, the negative scenario, the lowest intentions, and in the middle, you have those who were not exposed to any scenario. In addition, these results seems to be clearly shaped by pre-treatment conditions. In other terms, the context moderates the impact of economic uncertainty on fertility. Look, in Italy, where the economic context is quite turbulent, the positive economic narrative seems the most relevant in affecting fertility intentions. While in Norway, where the economic and financial context was relatively stable over the last year, it is the negative narrative of the future which seems especially important. So a sort of distant experience where the narrative is more distant to your daily life, then it is more effective in differentiating your behaviors. This is done before COVID. We completed this before COVID. So our narrative of the future, which is purely economic, is not affected by the pandemic so far in this experiment. Then what we are doing is through a combination of methods of natural language processing, we are building a quite new indicator of the level of economic uncertainty as filtered by the press and the social media. So we have two postdocs which have background in computer science, which are helping us in doing this. And this kind of indicator will allow us to describe how the press and social media narrative of the future is different between countries and has changed over time. And what we will be doing is to test this indicator as an aggregate level factor predicting infertility behaviors net of traditional structural constraints. I can tell you just some results that came out from the computer yesterday, and I think they are extremely promising. We found a quite strong effect of actually the volume and the tone of the news of the first Italian newscast, evening newscast, so TG1, from the first Italian channel on fertility behaviors over the last 10 years. So this is quite interesting, net of individual conditions and also the economic trends, the main economic, the major economic trends. Observational studies. Here it's difficult actually to operationalize narratives because you need surveys collecting both forward-looking measures of economic uncertainty and fertility. These kind of surveys are very few. I like to cite one paper, which is now forthcoming in population studies, which we conducted with Arianna Gatta, that I think is there somewhere. And with Arianna, we used the OECD Trust Lab survey for Italy. This survey explicitly includes some prospective measures of employment uncertainty and also fertility intentions, and we found quite strong effects, net of person-specific risk aversion and also net of the context, the economic context. And also with another colleague of mine, Danilo Bolano, we are using the Australian longitudinal study, the ILDA survey for Australia, that also includes forward-looking measures of the employment condition, and we found quite strong effects on both family formation and fertility in Australia. So finally, the fourth line of research is more qualitative. Do you remember our experiment? We have a control group. We decided also to make use of the control group. What we did in the control group was to ask them a series of open questions about the nature of uncertainty in their lives, the nature of uncertainty, the fear of the future, and we are exploring now with text analysis techniques all their answers to get a deeper insight into the mechanisms through which narratives of the future affects fertility. So I would be more than happy to show you more in depth the results of this four line of research. In case you would like to know more, feel absolutely free to email me. But let me use the opportunity of discussing with you some most recent work in progress we are doing. Because on the top of all what we have discussed so far, COVID-19 entered our lives, multiplying even more the sources of uncertainty and making our future less and less predictable. Here I'm showing you the results of a joint paper with Raffaele Guetto, who is a senior collaborator of the ESC project, and Giacomo Bazzani, who is a postdoc in Florence. So, as I said, the COVID-19 disaster has created an enormous uncertainty shock. 90% of newspaper articles were about in March 2020 mentioned COVID, coronavirus, pandemic, and other terms related to infectious diseases. And actually, in another paper, Baker and colleagues used forward-looking uncertainty indicators, in particular stock market volatility, newspaper economic uncertainty, and also subjective measures in business expectation surveys. Using these three key dimensions, they estimated that more than half of the economic contraction in the United States during that month was due to COVID-19-induced uncertainty. And within this context of COVID-19, Italy offers, unfortunately, a unique case study. Italy is the first severe case of COVID-19 pandemic in the Western world. Italian faced the longest complete lockdown experience, 2 months in total. At the end of April 2020, Italy had about 25,000 deaths due to COVID-19. And the media played a very strong role. Of course, presented this way may seem a bit caricatural, but daily at 6 p.m., Italians gathered in front of the TV for the official updates of the pandemic. And the TV announcement of the president, of the then president Conte, had more than 70% of share, the double of Italy playing the FIFA World Cup, basically. So from our point of view, the COVID-19 pandemic represents a unique occasion, a sort of natural experiment to test the narrative framework. So what we have done was to adapt our narrative framework to the experience of the coronavirus pandemic and also collected information concerning all the relevant dimensions to operationalize our framework. The key research question is whether young adults postpone fertility because their narrative of the future is uncertain, net of all the statistical shadow of the past. And our hypothesis, our key hypothesis, is that because of COVID-19 induced uncertainty, subjective states and personal narratives of the future, also influenced by media shared narratives, may gain the upper hand over the shadow of the past. We collected data through an online survey organized by the international survey company Lucid, known for its high academic reputation for quality and rigor of data collection. We combined a longitudinal survey, so the follow-up, we will do the follow-up this September, and an experimental approach. We have a total sample of 4,000 individuals. The data were collected during the last week of the first lockdown in Italy, so April 25, May 1st. And we had quota sampling on men and women aged 20 to 40. So clearly this is not a probabilistic sample, but based on data from the Italian National Statistical Office, we have set quotas for gender, age. And you may remember that in the first wave of diffusion of coronavirus, Italy was differently hit by the pandemic. So we have set quotas for the NAT3 level, so provinces in the north, and NAT2 level means regions in the center and the south. We collected information about past experience and personality traits, so socio-demographic background, risk aversion, education, status and objective exposition to coronavirus, direct and indirect contacts with coronavirus, media exposure, TV and web, labor market situation, so employment, social class, but also transitions to not employment or any smart work following the pandemic. Then we collected information about perceptions, so sense of insecurity regarding one's own health, labor market situation, the diffusion of the pandemics, and the general political and economic situation. In addition, we also collected information about expectations. How long do you think will it take before your personal situation comes back to its pre-pandemic condition? And how long do you think will it take before the economic and social situation in Italy comes back to its pre-pandemic condition? Then we also wanted to collect information about imaginaries. We might discuss about this. It is very complex. And here we were relying on the literature on affective forecasting and on the happiness literature. And we have asked how much having another child would make you happy. We collected information about fertility intentions retrospectively. So in January, before the coronavirus pandemic, it's questionable. I know the best would be before and after, but no other solutions are possible here on a scale from 0 to 10. And today, do you plan to have a child in the next 3 years? So I'm showing you the results in terms of change in fertility intentions because of the lockdown. I will simply show you results from a stepwise OLS regression on the change in fertility intentions. Our main explanatory variables are imaginaries, expectations, perception, status, past experiences. And of course, we control for the level of fertility intention in January. So be careful, the results I'm showing you now are not correlates of fertility intentions. These are correlates of change in fertility intentions from January to the last week of the lockdown. And I have also estimated a multinomial logistic regression to analyze the probability of fertility intentions decreasing, increasing, or remaining the same as before the pandemic. Very briefly through the results, our results suggest that perceptions, expectations, and imaginaries do play an important role in the change of fertility intentions after the pandemic, net of all other economic controls and socio-demographic controls. So first of all, those who reduce their fertility intentions are those who feel insecure about their health, work, and economic conditions. And those who have a more pessimistic expectation about the return to normality. And regarding imaginaries, a strong positive imaginary towards having children mitigates the negative impact of the pandemic. The objective status, so the actual labor market situation and any change in the labor market situation because of the pandemic, only played a minor role in the adaptation of fertility intentions during the pandemic. And what is more, part of the effects of the objective measures are shaped by perceptions, expectations, and imaginaries. In particular, and this is even striking, the effect of job losses and/or temporary interruptions in employment did not affect the change in fertility intentions, while all perceptions, expectations, and imaginaries did. Then, as I told you, we estimated a multinomial logistic regression to evaluate and compare the predicted probabilities of decreasing or increasing fertility intentions, so to have a more substantive interpretation of our results. The findings show that more negative expectations about the return to normality, the higher the probabilities of decreasing fertility intentions during the pandemic. Just an example, net of all covariates included in the model equation, those who expect that the return to normality will last more than 2 years have a probability of decreasing fertility intentions of about 25. Look how naive we were in showing, in setting the modalities of the answers, 3 months, 6 months, thinking now that we asked about a length of 3 months is very, it's super strange. But of course, we were in April 2020, and we were really in a condition of fundamental uncertainty. We were really in a condition of total ignorance about the length of the pandemic. On the other side, if you look at the right panel, the more negative expectations about return to normality, the lower the probabilities of increasing fertility intentions during the pandemic. And that, as I anticipated to you, we also combined our survey with an experiment at the end. So at the end of the survey, we also presented to the respondents a mock news bulletin concerning the expected end of the pandemic emergency. So respondents were randomly assigned to 5 different expected duration before the return to normality. This kind of manipulation should have sounded especially realistic. You might remember, at least some of you, those who were in Italy, that in that year, the President Conte announced a Comitato Tecnico Scientifico, so a group of experts who were supposed to work about the return to normality. So what we have done is to collect and to implement this experiment exactly the week after the announcement of this expert committee. And we said that these were the predictions of these experts about the expected length of the pandemic. So we then asked about the fertility intentions in the next 3 years in the light of the expected duration of the emergency and analyzed the change with respect to previously stated intentions. I have no time to show you the mock news bulletin. Of course, again, the a bit naive, the expected length of the pandemic, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 2 years, more than 2 years, but we were 1 year ago. We really didn't know. Before last summer, I will show you again the results in terms of change in fertility intentions. Our main explanatory factor here is, of course, the treatment. And then we are also improving the external validity of the findings by controlling for a set of coverage. Then we also control for the level of fertility intentions. And we also have a recall bias to check, a sort of a check about the manipulation. So, change in fertility intentions after the treatment by these different scenarios. The results here suggest that the more negative the narrative of the future, the stronger the reduction of the fertility intentions after the treatment. Of course, the randomization controls for alternative explanations, so including all control variables, just improves the statistical precision of the estimates here. Concluding. So, regarding the shadow of the past, we find that our objective indicators of individuals' exposure to health and economic consequences of the pandemic only played a quite limited role in reshaping individuals' fertility plan during the pandemic. But regarding the shadow of the future, we find that perceptions of insecurity and especially expectations and imaginaries came out as crucial moderators of individuals' adaptation to a new context characterized by overwhelming uncertainty. And the results are reinforced by our experimental approach that provide additional evidence of an impact of shared narratives of the future on fertility intentions. I think I concluded my time, so I just conclude by saying that more research is needed to address the role of personal and shared narratives about economic uncertainty in the study of family dynamics in our era of globalization, technological change, and now even coronavirus pandemic. Thank you.